we are also up against the military-industrial establishment. In any status quo, whoever is profiting from the status quo is rich right now. Rich means powerful. And if you're rich and powerful because of the way things are right now, you're not going to want the way things are right now to change. I tell this story at great length in The Truth About Food. This is a 200,000 word book. It's everything I know and how I know it. Now, The Truth About Food could be just 7 words and they wouldn't even be mine. They'd be Michael Pollan's, right? Eat food, not too much, mostly plants. The other 199,993 words are all about why it's so hard to turn that simple knowledge into routine action. And so in this book, I talk at length about the fact that big food profits from pseudo-confusion about diet, is able to sell us, if you will, lipstick on a pig, basically some new kind of junk food that's gluten-free or lectin-free or whatever the craze du jour happens to be. And so big food basically laughs about, you know, chronic disease and epidemic obesity all the way to the bank. And big pharma does the same because they wind up selling us all kinds of drugs to treat diseases we never needed to get in the first place. So there's big food, there's big pharma, there's big media, there's big publishing. There are a lot of really powerful entities that are making a killing off of killing us. They don't want it to change. So you've got to change it. You've got to be the change you want to see in the world. You've got to be the tip of the spear. You've got to pay it forward. We have to be the leading edge of a cultural revolution. I also hate the fact that we're such a polarized society, whether it's about the pandemic or vaccines or climate change or nutrition, because whenever dogma is barking, we have a really hard time hearing one another. So timely that my dogs, not dogma, bark during this talk, but you'll hear no dogma from me. Dogma is when you say it's my way or the highway. You know, what I believe or what I prefer is the only right way. You'll never hear that from me. I'm very interested in the confluence of science, sense, and expert consensus. I will absolutely tell you my personal preferences, but I will try very hard not to conflate my personal preferences with my knowledge. What I know based on facts is not negotiable. My opinion is just an opinion. I'll tell you why. I may be able to defend it. But when dogma barks, whether it's your dogma or my dogma, we'll have a hard time hearing one another. And we don't learn much when we can't listen. We never learn anything when the only opinion we're willing to hear is the one we already own. We've got to do a better job of listening to one another and reflecting. And maybe we'll disagree, but we can do that with civility and respect. Less dogma. There should be no dogma on the menu. And then I told you a while ago, while talking about Michael Pollan, I would also talk about Michael Moss. And one of the things we're up against is what I call the Moss effect. I don't know that Michael would thank me for that, but Michael Moss is a Pulitzer Prize winning investigative journalist, wrote Salt, Sugar, Fat. His latest book is recently out, Hooked. He wrote this New York Times Magazine cover story, The Extraordinary Science of Addictive Junk Food. And this tells the tale. Basically, of the fact that none of this is accidental. All the big food companies hire teams of scientists to help them design foods people can't stop eating till their arms get tired from lifting them to their mouths. They play around with the texture. They play around with flavors. They do everything to maximally stimulate the appetite center in the hypothalamus. And how do they know they're maximally stimulating the human appetite center in the ventromedial hypothalamus? They use functional MRI scanners. So they actually study brain activity in response to various food ingredients and then use the formulas that light the hypothalamus up like a Christmas tree. And then you and everybody else is supposed to practice restraint and portion control. It's absurd. The food supply is booby-trapped, literally booby-trapped. Now, you can avoid that by eating foods that nobody's mucked around with. If you eat foods direct from nature, foods with an ingredient list of one word, like blueberries, you know, nobody's mucked around with those. And so I told you when I presented Michael Pollan's 7 words, eat food, not too much, mostly plants, the middle portion, not too much, takes care of itself. And this is how. If you go from highly processed foods that have been manipulated to maximize the calories it takes to feel full to unprocessed foods, you minimize the calories it takes to feel full. It's one of the many virtues of unprocessed or minimally processed foods. And so you actually fill up on fewer calories. And if you fill up to satisfaction, you stop eating. And if you can do that before you've overeaten calories, weight control can occur without being hungry all the time. And that's the formula. That's a formula I've shared with patients for 30 years. It's the formula I practice myself. I weigh pretty much what I weighed when I graduated high school. and have fluctuated minimally in all the years since. And it's not because I don't gain weight easily. I do, but I eat real food and I eat plants and they fill me up to satisfaction. And I eat as much as I want and I stop when I'm full and I don't count calories and it's all good. And I definitely recommend that over counting calories or, you know, trying to eat less than you want every day for the rest of your life, because that tends to be what we call a diet. It lasts about 6 weeks and then people fall off the wagon. But if you eat a diet of wholesome foods, there is no wagon to fall off of. It's just a way of living. It works forever. All right. So those are some of the challenges we face. How do we overcome them? What are our assets? Well, we have good assets. In addition to the science we have and the sense we have, we do have the solace of accord. We have a global expert consensus. So we can meet the challenge of discord with the solace of accord. And I know this because I've addressed it directly at many points along the way in my career. In 2015, I was privileged to co-chair with Walter Willett this conference in Boston, Old Ways Finding Common Ground. So Old Ways was our sponsor. We brought feuding nutrition experts from all around the world, literally, who had very different perspectives. So, you know, you may not like this, but we brought experts who favored eating dairy. We brought in experts who favored eating meat or paleo. We gave everybody the opportunity to present their arguments to the audience. And then in between sessions, we worked together behind the scenes to find our common ground. And we did. And we published it. And you can Google Old Ways Common Ground. And what you'll see is what everybody agreed on, whatever their point of view is, that for the sake of human health and animal health and planetary health, everybody needs a diet of less processed food and it needs to be plant predominant. And even the paleo experts agreed and, you know, whatever position people came from. So, you know, you may be bothered by the fact that there wasn't 100% agreement, but I would argue that 85, 90% agreement, that's pretty damn good. If we could just act on that, it would do a world of good. And I mean, save lives, add years to lives, add life to years, save our fellow creatures, stabilize the climate, preserve our aquifers, save the Amazon, you know, a world of good. If we were just getting it 90% right at the scale of all humanity. So we shouldn't make perfect the enemy of the good. This is a really good consensus statement. Check it out. So just Google Old Ways Common Ground. It's all there for you. And then at an even grander scale, my nonprofit, the True Health Initiative, we have brought together roughly 500 leading experts, many of the speakers at this conference among them, from 46 countries at last count, and across a great diversity of perspective, again, from paleo to vegan, everything in between, to say we agree. We agree about the fundamentals that are most important to advancing human health on a sustainably vital planet. Please visit us, truehealthinitiative.org. Please join us. Please support us. We would very much welcome you. In unity, there is strength. And then we need to think about making it easier to get there from here for both individuals and the body politic. And again, just to remind you, I'm talking about the things we have or need to get around the obstacles in our way, if we're going to turn knowledge into power. I've long talked about skill power. We talk a lot about willpower. You almost never hear about its neglected half-sibling, skill power. But healthy people have skills. You guys probably all have skills. You know, people who come to health conferences routinely, you've got skills. You learn a lot. You empower yourselves with knowledge, information. You have skills. Everything important requires skills. It took skill to learn the alphabet. We acquired that skill. It was painful in kindergarten and, you know, we got over it and it's been useful ever since, right? Most of us learned how to ride a bike. That was painful. We skinned our knees any number of times, but then useful for the rest of our lives. Healthy living takes skills. Those skills can be taught to everybody. And I've equated obesity and chronic disease in a culture that's awash in hyper-processed, hyper-palatable calories and labor-saving technology to drowning. It's like drowning in calories and technology. And so what do we do about drowning? We don't wait for people to drown to resuscitate them. We teach kids to swim. We put fences around pools. We put lifeguards at beaches. We put up a sign that says, don't go in the water today, there's a riptide. All those same things should be done in our society with regard to obesity and chronic disease. But for now, I'm emphasizing the importance of teaching everybody to swim, skill power. That ought to be done. However, I do believe it's unfair to leave this burden with the individual. Remember that in the blue zones, nobody's working hard. They eat well because it's normal to eat well. They're not trying. They don't have more willpower than we do. They may not even have more skill power than we do. Their culture has more skill power for healthy living, but the individuals don't. They just eat the way everybody eats. And sadly, the blue zones may go away as they become victims of our effective exporting of McDonald's and Coca-Cola. But for now, they benefit because their culture gets it right. The body politic does the right thing. And so everybody doesn't need to work quite so hard to take care of themselves. And that's what we want. And that requires a cultural revolution. We have to open everybody's eyes to the incredible value proposition of getting diet and lifestyle right, adding years to lives, adding life to years, eliminating 80% of chronic disease and premature death, and stabilizing and saving this magnificent planet we all call home. We need a revolution.